every point at the rail on exchange flags. Kindly ensure all mobile phones are switched off. Thank you.
Good evening, Lord Mayor. Good evening, members. Can I advise members that these scraps since have been received from councillors Tony Conception, Michelle Corrigan, Beatrice Frankel, Ross Groves and Harold Sung. Are there any more apologies, please?
Can I remind the Vice President that this meeting is held in public and is not a public meeting? I would also like to emphasise that this is a key public meeting, and I therefore request that everyone present, including the public, treat this meeting accordingly, which will enable the business to be dealt with more effectively. The use of social media and filming for reporting proceedings is permitted during council meetings. This does not extend to the filming of members of the public, and anyone wishing to film the proceedings are also particularly directed to the very sensitive issue of filming children without the express permission of their parents. Thank you.
My question's interest, Lord Mayor. Can I remind members that you are only required to declare at meetings any disclosable, pecuniary or prejudicial interests, in which case the member will need to leave the chamber during the consideration of that item. Are there any such declarations, please?
Are the minutes of the extraordinary City Council meeting and the annual City Council meeting held on the 25th of May agreed? Thank you.
Well, I wonder if I could ask a legal question of the Chief Executive.
Is this to do with the minutes?
No, I've already finished the minutes. No, well, 1 minute ago, sorry.
Okay,
yes. Thank you. I tabled a question to the Council about whether or not the police have been inquiring into payments made from the Merseyside Pension Fund on behalf of a former employee of the council. I spoke to the superintendent from the Lancashire Police who is investigating this matter. He said he had no objection with this question being raised, so therefore I raised it. It does not appear on the board at the back, and I've had no explanation, no suggestion from any officer of the council that it wouldn't be raised. So I want to know why is it being stopped and why wasn't I informed of it?
Lord Mayor, we are aware of the question that Councillor Kemp refers to, that the reason it hasn't been included in the agenda for this evening's meeting is because we haven't had confirmation from the police that they are happy for information to be disclosed around that particular question. So I'd be very grateful for confirmation from you as to the content of the information you have, because we haven't had that.
Well, as you obviously know, the phone number of the Chief Inspector of Lancashire Police, because you rang him, I would have thought it would be possible for you to do that again. Because that's how I found out that you were concerned about it, because the Chief Superintendent rang me, made it clear that he'd only done so at your request, made it clear that he even then had thought of not doing it. So a simple phone call for a number that you already know would have sufficed for you to find that information. I must say, Chief Executive, I found that answer totally unsatisfactory.
Can I just say something? Response from the Chief Executive, and then this matter, as far as this meeting is going to be closed, and you can have a discussion afterwards, okay?
Look, Mayor, I stand by what I said to Council. We have made inquiries of the police. They have not returned the calls to our satisfaction to disclose information in public. You might have different information, I certainly haven't.
Okay, I think we pursue this outside of this meeting. I think you made your point.
Possibly in court, by
the way. Possibly in court. Thank you.
Not me, the police.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Can I advise the Council that three statements have been received for this evening's meeting? The first statement is received from Lila Bennett in relation to item 8 on the agenda.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. as constituents of Gosford Ward. We are also supported here today by members of Liverpool Rugby, representatives from across the North West, as Liverpool was the first amendment group formed in this area. We are over 100 strong, one of the biggest WASPI groups in the country. I want the Chair's permission to give you all a stop tour of WASPI. It was founded by Anne Key from Rainhill, who's actually here today. Thank you, Anne, for attending. And it's the woman responsible for being the bringing of this group half-hour, for which we are very thankful. Anne was shortly joined by four of the women on social media, and they found out by chance they were not to receive the state pension they had contracted with the government at the entitled age of 60. Through social media, the message was spread, encouraging women to speak out, and so we grew, with a national WASPI membership of over 40,000. The campaign highlights the way the 1995-2000 Pensions Act have resulted in the generation of women born after the 1st of April 1951 have been grotesquely disadvantaged, many thousands of women left impoverished, and dreams of a happy and stress-free later life being left dashed to the rocks. The acronym WASPI stands for Women Against State Pension Inequality. This does not mean we are against equalisation of the state pension, as the government suggests. Not at all. But we are against the unfair way the acts have been implemented and the lack of a fair notice they have been given to 2.1 million women and their families who have been affected. Thousands of women across Liverpool and the rest of Merseyside are affected by this. We do not apportion blame to any political party, and we are proud that we've had 40 debates in the House of Parliament, and we have recently been able to form an all-party political group, an APPG, that has over 120 MPs, with chairs and vice-chairs from all parties. They remain steadfast in finding a solution to this injustice. I want to give you a short but important summary of events. The 1995 Pensions Act increased the pension to 65 for anyone born after the 6th of April 1951. Unfortunately, nobody bothered to tell them. We now contacted these women to inform them of this fact, and a freedom of information acquired by Paul Lewis from Moneybox substantiated this. There are arguments that tiny articles are paid in newspapers and magazines, and even a mention on a news programme. I'm not sure what any of you were doing in 1995, but I can't remember every part of it. I know I was working for the City Council, and that was as far as I knew. And I was working full time. I was just waiting to become a grandmother, which I was really proud of, looking after my 10-year-old father-in-law, trying to run a household with a husband who'd just been made redundant, and two other children. I'm trying to live my life as any other woman, with all those responsibilities would. I was far too busy and didn't really have much time for news articles, and even less for watching some unknown programme where apparently they might have mentioned the changes. They should have sent me a letter. And for some of these women who were born between the 6th of April 51 and the 5th of April 53, they received theirs 14 years after the 1995 Pensions Act. Now fast forward to 2011. This time, the government decided to accelerate the state pension for women to 65 by 2018, plus increase to 66 for both men and women by 2020. They ignored recommendations from SAGA and the Turner Commission to give a minimum of 10 years notice to those affected. Letters started going out in 2009 for some, but the women most affected by both acts, who were born after the 6th of April 53, so the 5th of October 1954 didn't start going out until 2011. Indeed, some women received as little 1 year's notice or nothing at all. Also, the acceleration meant that a year's difference in age could mean 3 years' difference in the receipt of a state pension. So what has this impact had on women? Well, for me, up to date, a loss of £30,000. It was 29, as you can see on the back of my sash. Into my household, the choice of how I spend my life after thinking I was retiring and receiving my contractual state pension at 60. I won't receive this, and I won't receive the £155 flat state pension now quoted back for everyone, I would receive £130 a week as I was contracted out for a part of my working life. This is what's happening for many thousands of women across the country. Some of the women in our group are so impoverished in serious physical or mental health and in dire straits by these acts. Some have been forced to sell their family homes after 40 years and bought smaller homes and living off the equity. But even this now is dwindling and they have less than 3 months' worth of income. What do they do? Sell a house? Go sofa surfing or move in with their children? That's if they've got children. We were the first generation of women to sign up for the right to pay full national insurance contributions. As we wanted our pensions in our own right, although thousands of us were on low pay, in low skills jobs with no equality until 1974 in relation to men's pay. Many women have full national insurance records, but after 40 years plus, we have been told we are not entitled to any benefits. JSA in the last 6 months, with little prospects of a job and the humiliation of the work programme, having to do physically challenging work experiences and facing sanctions for not completing sufficient job applications. It's about 20 a week. Finally, just a thought. We've been discouraged from signing on for JSA, with the effort being an uphill struggle and demoralising struggle. This means no access to building up NI credits. However, until recently, a man reaching the age of 60 and not in work automatically got NI credits until he reached the pensional age of 65. They don't have to claim JSA or attend any demoralising work programmes. And the government will say we're against equalisation. Thank you, Chair.
Most. And I guess
authority of the city. If Liverpool aspires to be a global city, then we should make certain that new arrivals are safe and welcome, as well as ensure zero tolerance to hate crime. Liverpool is a very dynamic place with changing population, and we all need to make sure that people feel sense of belonging. Because often the first experience when you arrive in the city determines whether you close yourself or whether you contribute to the community. We still need to educate people, give them opportunity to make links with each other, and feel that they contribute to the vision and reality of what Liverpool is. If Liverpool is a success story, we want the people to be part of it. I'm talking to you more from the community perspective. There are many fantastic community leaders who are very committed to the city. The question is if the city is committed to support them. We all know that the council will be going through another wave of cuts, so how can we work closer together in response to that? Our response to the needs of the Polish and local community was establishing Wednesday Polonia. And I feel that Wednesday Polonia contributed to how Polish and other minorities are perceived here. It's an example of how we can approach community decision. Wednesday Polonia organized many community events, including local and new communities, where we presented traditions and culture of Polish and other minorities, so local people could get to know us and vice versa. We offered volunteering opportunities that help build in newcomers a sense of belonging and understand the cultural differences. We contributed to the commemoration events of World War II to show that history divides us together. We deliver presentations to local service providers, raising awareness and understanding of the new communities, and working with them to overcome the barriers and accessing services. We speak to local media and national media, challenging negative stereotypes of migrants and presenting their positive contribution to the society. I've been running Wednesday Polonia with an outstanding group of volunteers for the last 8 years, but I need your support because I believe that it can really make a difference. I love this city, I am part of it, and I want to make sure that the richness of the communities that make it is valued and recognized and contribute to the city's success. I want everyone to feel part of Liverpool's makers.
I'm also divisional secretary of the Liverpool MUT. I congratulate you. Anthony Trust by 2022.
I applaud Council's determination to support local schools and champion the importance of a local, democratic and elected middle tier in education. The proposals in the white paper, Educational Excellence Everywhere, is a complete distraction from the very real problems facing schools in our city. The changes will not only create complete turmoil, but will cost hundreds of thousands of pounds at a time when schools' budgets are being cut to the core. This will result in larger class sizes, subjects being cut from the curriculum, the loss of teacher resources, and teachers and support staff being made redundant. And let us remember that over 80% of local authority schools are rated good or outstanding and have not chosen to become academies, so why force them to change? Multi-academy trusts won't be required to have parent governors or even governing bodies for individual schools, and once a school joins a MAT, a multi-academy trust, there is no way for it to decide to leave. Far from giving more autonomy to head teachers, MATs can remove self-management altogether. A programme originally claimed to be about choice will deny parents, teachers and schools any real choice, and also deny parents a voice in their children's education. When all schools are academies, existing national pay conditions will not apply automatically to anyone and might end altogether. So far in Liverpool, the teacher trade unions have been successful in maintaining our national pay conditions. However, some other authorities haven't achieved this. At present, most academies follow school teachers' pay conditions, but if it disappears, they will be able to drive down pay and conditions. Working hours and workload will rise even more. Disputes will proliferate at school and multi-academy trust level. This won't help persuade our best graduates to choose a career in teaching. The government says a new, stronger accreditation will replace qualified teacher status, with trainees accredited by their teachers and the requirements of several years to reach full accreditation. The new stronger accreditation will be nothing but the sort. Removing universities from the accreditation process will end the availability of research and evidence to inform better teacher education and teaching. Teachers' futures will depend on their relationship with the head teacher. Local authorities will lose most of their responsibilities for supporting schools. Academies or their multi-academy trusts will become their own admission authorities. This will inevitably disadvantage children from poorer backgrounds, with special educational needs or with English as an additional language the most. The real issues that schools and parents are facing is a chronic teacher shortage, a lack of school places, chaos around curriculum changes, primary tests and a funding crisis. But instead of dealing with these very real issues, the government is pursuing a top-down reorganisation of education that has no basis in evidence to support it. When Justin Greening, the new Education Secretary, states, "I learnt best where there were great teachers who could excite me about learning." Fundamentally, we need to look at what's happening in the classroom. I say to her, there are many great teachers in our schools in this city and excellent education going on in our classrooms. So listen to us. We're the experts. We're in the classrooms day after day. We care about our students, and we know that this white paper will destroy our education system and damage the future prospects of our children. In finishing, I would like to thank Council and Nick Ford, the Education Minister. For
Real examples of that in terms of the number of buildings that we've invested in to bring back into use, and including adding buildings onto the list of protected buildings, like, for instance, the Little Bridge building, which last Friday we announced a £5 million injection into that building to create TV and film studios, which creates around about 300 jobs. That shows our commitment to protect our heritage and our buildings within the city. So we will not be responding in a positive way to UNESCO about following their recommendation that we have on the moratorium. We'll be explaining and highlighting what we've done to protect buildings and what we'll continue to do in regard to protecting buildings. But we won't put a pause on development in our city for 2 years. And one of the reasons why it's important that people understand that, and it's an announcement that I think is appropriate in terms of this request by UNESCO, is that by the end of this year, we will have submitted a planning application for a new cruise liner terminal. Now, that will go ahead, as I said, by the end of the year. If we were to abide by UNESCO's request, we couldn't do that. Equally, there's £30 million RGF funding that is going into that site to help with the regeneration of that particular site. And again, if we were to abide by UNESCO's request, that wouldn't happen. So there is a clear, difficult position for us. We can either abide by that and lose those regeneration projects. Now, what we've got by way of a commitment from Cunard is that by 2018, Cunard will establish the Liverpool to New York run, something that I think is an iconic arrangement between two great cities, and one which Cunard told me that they will honour if we have that cruise line and terminal built. So that is a risk, and that is another reason why we won't be following that request. So it is important, as I said, that you understand the full context and the full reason why we are refusing to meet that request. It's the only issue for our answer to make by way of mail and actually support it.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, sorry.
We are now able to, just on those 3 points. I just want to say I agree with the Mayor on all three of them. Without deciding what happened in the case of the custody problem, it is absolutely right that this should be properly and publicly and transparently investigated. I can give him my assurance on behalf of my colleagues, not only in Liverpool, but throughout the rest of the city region, that we will work with him and his colleagues throughout the city region to deal with the severe problems which have been raised post-Brexit. The day after the referendum result was announced, the Mayor did ask me whether I'd give that commitment in cyber before that I talked to my colleagues. I have done, and we've submitted a paper to him looking at the areas that we would feel a critique of what's happening, but in a positive way, in a way that we want to add on to what's going on. I will deal with that a bit more on the resolution from Councillor Miller later. And lastly, I think that there has been a huge overkill here on behalf of UNESCO. No one is more critical than me than some of the things that are going up in the city centre. But there's also some very good buildings going up in the city centre, and we shouldn't throw the baby out with the bathwater. So I don't know how Mayor intends to deal with it, because this is only advisory. But as someone who has shown himself and my colleagues to be concerned about with architecture, I'd be happy to work with him again on this issue to make sure we do what's good but don't do what's bad. But you cannot stifle our city centre for 2 years without much greater evidence than has been presented so far.
Councillor Rafferty.
I respectfully slightly Mayor Anderson's critique of how it's being approached to the referendum. I think it's probably more important to ask the people who approach it to liberate the country from the EU while they voted rather than presume how they did or didn't vote. But I think Ken Clark said on television last night there's very little to be gained from rehearsing why people did or didn't vote. What we need to know how to do is deal with the current situation. Whilst legally you may present us with problems, it may also present us with opportunities. And I'd like to thank the Mayor on behalf of the Liberal Group that he did convene a joint meeting of all party leaders across the region to try and discuss through how we deal with the situation, how we look at difficulties and challenges, and we all continue to contribute that. Lastly, on the issue of UNESCO, and I think there is a real problem for those of us on the planning committee, we have a planning committee. We have legislation which dictates what we decide and how we to do, and we have to use the discretion. And maybe it would be nice to UNESCO might want to come along to the planning committee one day.
Thank you.
Just a quick response to Councillor Blackers on your, of course. Your view will and has always differed from mine on the euro. As somebody that spent months out and about talking to people, it was absolutely clear to me that the main reason why people were voting to leave across Liverpool City region was because of austerity. Austerity was inflicted on us not by the European Union, but by a Conservative government and Conservative ideology. And it was absolutely, for me, something that will go down in the annals of history of how people were hoodwinked into voting for Leave when they now fully understand that the commitments that they were given are not going to happen. And history will judge us on that. And I know, that they will judge me and many, many millions of us who are to be made as right on that particular issue. With regards to the heritage issue, you absolutely made my point in response to Councillor Kemp, who I know was agreeing in part with me. We have a planning process here. We have not in any way broke any of the conditions on North Liverpool in terms of the field project or any project within the city. We've not broken any of those. And if we had, I'd be the first to admit it. We haven't. And the way we do it and the way we deal with it, in fact, two of the buildings that were highlighted by one in particular was granted outline planning permission for 38 stories. It's actually only going to be 34 stories. So for me, I'm absolutely delighted to say that there is nothing that UNESCO should be concerned about. But it's important that we send a clear message to investors and to people who want to come to Liverpool that we are open for business and we are not restricted or fettered in any way. Because I firmly believe that people come here to see our heritage. You don't come here to see a slap line or a certificate saying we are the real heritage site. They come here to see what we've got to offer, and we want to create even more of an offer to those people.
Thank you, Mayor Anderson. Moving on to item 6, changing the committee membership.
Appointments, Councillor Bean. Thank you, Lord. The committee changes the appointments of outside bodies on the
committee. Is that agreed? Item 7, appointment to local authority
representative. Thank you, Lord Mayor. To move the recommendations set out on pages 57 to 59 of the council agenda, and also with the additional nomination of Councillor Helen Thompson for Pebble Vale Primary School be approved.
That's agreed.
Yeah.
Right, moving on to motions. Can I remind members in terms of the timing of speeches that the mover of the motion gets 5 minutes and has the right to reply, which is also 5 minutes. All of the speakers get 3 minutes and 2 minutes for extensions if agreed by the council. Okay, with regard to the suspension of standing orders, can I advise that in accordance with standing order 21.2, I have received a request to consider an urgent motion submitted by Councillor Peter Mitchell entitled Public Inquiry into Aubrey. Having consulted with the City Solicitor, I am satisfied that the reason for urgency given for this motion is valid. That being the role of police force concerned in other matters relating to their policing methods and accountability. I have therefore accepted the motion to debate as an urgent item and now call on Councillor Mitchell to move the motion, a copy of the motion as set out in Appendix C to this note. Okay? So, item 19, public inquiry into Aubrey by Councillor Peter Mitchell. Can you move the motion, please, Peter? I second the motion and reserve the right to speak. Okay. Councillor Notes. Okay, Councillor.
Thank you, my Lord. Thank you, Council, for taking this urgent motion. Can I assure Council this is not me or Councillor Cushman trying to refight the battles of the 1980s. This is entirely about truth and justice. And that's exactly what this motion refers to. Andy Vernon raised this issue in the House today, asked Prime Minister's questions and called for a public inquiry to the new Prime Minister. She, in a nutshell, told them that she didn't want to move too quickly. It's been 32 years. 32 years. When I was wondering how to talk about and remind people who may be too young to remember what happened in those Yorkshire minefields,